a situation where the way we talk about things, the way we see things, it's a language. It's the way we communicate things. It's not 100% what reality actually is. Yeah. You know, even Stephen and I are having this talk, we're doing it over different technology, we're in different locations, different continents, different times, but we're right. talking about a similar topic. If we were sitting right next to each other and we had read the same book, we would still have picked out different parts of it, read it at different times, had different things in our lived experiences that called back to this. So even if you have a time when you can get everyone in the world to quote unquote experience everything in the same way, at the same time, and everyone has seen the same things, heard the same things in a language they can actually understand and see, there's still their own personal experiences. Still the simple thing that even if two twins are sitting there experiencing something, one of them is standing right here, the other one is standing right there, and just that little difference might make them see something that wasn't happening to the other person. So with Marcuse, we're kind of thinking, with some of the things in Professor Torrance, I was thinking, what if he had more information? What if he found out that, hey, maybe what was happening in Russia was actually horrible? Let's say he had found out about the Holodomor. Would he still have written the same way about those places? If he found out about the actual death toll and the Great Leap Forward, would he have written the same things about that? And would he have, if he actually found out about the amount of actual human flourishing in comparison to more accurate understanding of how horrific history has actually been, and in reality, it was just he was living in a time when people were starting to actually report things a lot more accurately, and horrific things, bad things, harm sticks out more than the positives. So it was a lot more common coming out of the World War II situation to see all the suffering that was happening in humanity and have that more mythical kind of idea of what history was. And with history, the people who are writing history were the people who were living the best of their life in history. You weren't hearing about majority of the peasants, majority of the people that were just illiterate, that never actually, that were pretty much living like apes, like just our ape cousins in the woods, like just barely out of the Bronze Age type of thing, doing below Bronze Age in some situations. They didn't write books. When you heard about Victorian Age, most of the stuff you were hearing about were the people living in the manors. You weren't hearing about 99% of the population that was living 40 people in a building. Right? It wasn't 40 people, but they had the situation where it's like a room. They had curtains and sheets, kind of multiple families in there.
Yeah.
Parents having intercourse with the kids just sitting there. Like people in a mess, men and women just living together in different situations, all going to factories, no real wage gap difference or work-death gap difference because it was the kids, the family, everybody was in the factory. Like, those are not the people that you hear about.
Yeah.
So we hear about the queens, the kings, and we think that's how people were back then. Things were more in a state of nature. People were happier. It's like, no, no, no. Things were a lot more horrific back then. So I was thinking with this, I think it's a positive thing to see that this is something that came after Oppressive Tone. So we're going to try and see. I mean, I'm looking forward to seeing if there's some things where he's like, okay, he's learned something different, and now this is kind of a little change in how he wrote in Oppressive Tone. I'm not counting on it because there might be some other things involved in there, but I'm interested to see.
Well, I wanted to make a few comments. So in addition to this, I also watched two interviews with Marcuse towards the end of his life. One was in the mid-70s. The other was in 79, actually, the year he died. I think he died like 3 months after this last interview. And it's interesting because he was a Marxist to the end, because they said, are you a Marxist? He said, yes, I understand that people don't like that term, and I disagree with a lot of people who would identify as this. Now, in fairness to him, my understanding is he did denounce what happened in the Soviet Union, but then somebody said, like, why do you still believe in Marxism after this? And he laughed and said, because it's right. So he had a very religious fervor on this belief system. And I haven't read it, but I watched Matt Taibbi, who we discussed in the Substack video. He debated someone on Marcuse. He also wrote that piece on him, and he said that, I guess in One Dimensional Man, Marcuse talks about how he actually went to an auto factory and talked to the workers there, because that's one of the criticisms of Marx, which I and others have made, is that as far as we know, Marx never set foot in a factory. He read about factories from a book that Engels had written, and they said Engels, some of it was fake and some of it was out of date. So it's like, you know, Marx wasn't even having good source materials, but Marcuse actually went to an auto plant, decided to talk to workers, and I guess one of his inspirations in One Dimensional Man was, he talked about the whole idea of false consciousness, and he went to these auto workers and he's like, you know, are you guys happy? Don't you want a better life? And I guess, remember, this is in the 60s and 70s, and living standards were continuing to improve. And they basically said, like, look, you know, we don't have a perfect life, but overall things are pretty good. We don't see a need to tear down the system. And this sort of shows the split in Marxism between the intellectuals and the workers, because the idea was in classical Marxism is that, oh, the workers figure out things are bad, wake up and destroy the system. But then, of course, it's like, oh, for some reason they're not waking up. And the Marxists would say, well, they have false consciousness. They've been brainwashed into thinking they're better than they are. But, you know, I and others would argue, no, they're just happy with their lives. So as long as they benefit from the status quo, at least to a point, they're not going to tear things down. But I think Marcuse saw it as like somehow it was his duty to wake people up and help overthrow the system. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's something that it's depending on projecting people's values onto other people. You know, where somebody might have an ideology, or someone might think, oh, I know this God, and this God is the way to eternal good. So I need to, it's up to me, it's a calling for me to make sure everybody else sees this. It's that kind of bit of a white man's burden. It's a bit of the things that goes behind the missionaries, where the missionaries feel like, yes, you might seem to be okay in your village, and you've been living in this culture for millennia, and you might think you're okay, but no, because I know the actual things that are better than that, this high level of goodness, that it would be a failing on my part in order to not tell you about this thing and convince you that what you've been doing is wrong. And they will be able to find certain things and say, okay, that can improve in something. But that other person, if they could study your life, they might have some things and they say, oh, there's something in your life. This whole idea, we're just talking about this earlier before we started recording, talking about this whole lived experience type of things, or this living wage type of thing. It's like people make those decisions of how they want to live in certain places. If you're not actually dying, and my channel's name is Dying Alive, so it's kind of a thing with the opposite of the living dead, the zombie thing. Well, if you just sit and do nothing, you're technically dying. Yeah. But whenever you actually do something, you're actually living. What you're doing is enabling your living. So depending on the kind of quality of life that you want, it's going to affect certain things. Like one thing here in, I mean, recording this from Nairobi, Kenya, is you see the massive slums. There's multiple very big slums here in Nairobi, Kenya. The world's biggest slum, I think one of them, still world's biggest slum, Kibera slums. It's about 1 million people in there. And when you're talking about slum, some of the places, it's definitely improved a lot, even just over the time, last 10 years, last 20 years, my lifetime, compared to how it was before. But you still see some places where there's like corrugated metal homes, like there's still like people getting power lines, this is jacking power lines from the different power cables going on, open sewage, trash. That stuff's being cleaned up slowly by slowly and surely. And now they're getting more stable things. But there used to be just a regular thing of fires coming through, burning the places down, people living in squalor and situations like that. But oddly enough, this could be also because of the testing. With the current pandemic, it didn't really come in and wipe people out in a different sense. But there's other things that would go like cholera, other kind of, if somebody gets injured, somebody gets assaulted. Some of the structures aren't there. But a lot of those people come from the village. And in the different village ancestral lands, they normally come from families where they leave plots of land there. They could actually be living there. But back there, you're talking about Kenya, I think, is 35% or so electrified. So you still have places like the villages where my parents lived and grew up just now, just recently, a few years ago, finally got electricity to their main homesteads. Wow. So you're talking, those people live that. They leave that. It's still land. It's still some security. They could work off the land. They could farm. They have the community there. People speak the same language they speak. It's a long history. They have relatives and things like that. Now, going into the quality of life, there's things in there with the type of parenting, the different possibilities and the hopes and the dreams, but they still decide, a lot of these people decide to leave that life, state of nature, where people say, oh, we're not dealing with racism, we're not dealing with all this technology, we're living off the earth, everything organic, this and this, like that kind of situation, they leave that to come to live in a slum. Because there's a chance that they feel, okay, if I'm in this place, maybe my kid can go to some school in this area and then they can get into college and they can have this, or they can personally get a job. And even with those low-income jobs where they're making maybe $5 a day, if that, or $5 a week in some cases in some people, they still have enough to somehow send some money back to the village and have some things coming up in there. So these kind of situations, but why are those people deciding to leave that kind of environment to live in a slum in Nairobi? In the kind of situation where your average Westerner lives in, like the quality of life gap between those two people is bigger than it's ever been, than it was for majority of history. When you're talking about kings versus the lowest of the peasants, like for the majority of history, but that's what they choose to do. But it's something that I cannot imagine doing that. Like, it's like, to me, going to the slum, I can't imagine that, but I can imagine more going to the village. So that's kind of just different understandings. And I think just a long way to say with Marcuse, what is it about Marcuse's mindset that he could go and he saw those people and he wasn't able to break that understanding and see that these people actually had a previous life that was so different that the life that he thinks was squalor and horrific for them due to their lived experiences and their points of views, that was actually a big step up from what they actually had in their whole value system and their whole point of view in the world and things like that. Yeah.
Well, what I was going to say, in one of those interviews, he talks about the tension between the intellectuals and the workers, like the whole idea of, oh, the intellectuals, they sometimes see themselves as better than the workers. And you kind of get that theme in his writings, the idea that we're supposed to be uplifting the workers, but at the same time, we kind of look down on them. Like, he doesn't say that explicitly, but you kind of get that vibe. And then the workers in turn look at the intellectuals and are like, wait a minute, we're out here physically doing things, sweating. You're just writing up theories in a book. Why should you deserve credit? So there's sort of that tension. And I think this is where he talks about it in this essay we'll get into, but he talks about this is why they reached out to minorities. I think he talks, I forget in here, one of the works he talks about the disabled, things like that. And that sort of foreshadowed disability studies, intersectionality, things like that. Because the idea of, well, if the workers aren't waking up to these ideas, who can we wake up to these ideas? And I think, well, the way I like to explain the false consciousness thing to people who aren't as familiar, that I explain, the think of the Joe Sixpack stereotype, like the guy who goes, works a blue collar job, comes, either goes home, sits in front of his TV with beer, goes to a sports bar, cheers on a team with his friends, goes to sleep, does it over the next day. To some people, that's what life is. That's enjoyable. But I think people like Marcuse, very intelligent, very high-minded intellectuals, they look down on that. They're like, how can anyone find that fun? And then I had mentioned in a previous discussion, Theodore Adorno spent a lot of time critiquing popular culture, especially jazz music. And there's sort of this contempt, oh, the masses enjoy this. I really, you know, I wish they would appreciate the high-minded culture. And look, I mean, you liked my recent post, Two Steps from Hell. That's one of my favorite groups as far as music. And like, I wish people would listen to and appreciate music like that, but I don't feel it's my duty to somehow get everyone to listen to that. If the masses want to go out and listen to Cardi B, that's their choice. I don't feel like somehow I should wake people up and get them to appreciate this other music and then they'll become enlightened, or, you know, that seems to be.
Thank you for listening. This has been a clip from an actual longer recording that I'll try to leave a link to on the screen or somewhere around here where you're listening to this.
Peasants.
Peasants.
Okay. Okay.